Okay, so our masterclass is called Gamifying the Circular Civic and Sharing Economy. And when I made this presentation, I thought about this title. I actually realized, well, you can interpret that on two different levels. Oh, there's a spell error, actually. So on one hand, you can do it on an object level. On the other hand, you can do it on a meta level. So we're not going to do it on an object level, actually. But we're going to do it on a meta level. However, I'm going to talk about an object level, since that would be our general conceivement, the way we would conceive gamification of economies. So why should we gamify then? Well, one of the things is that can everybody understand me when I'm simply talking like this? Because I really like that one. Yeah? It's all clear? Okay, great. Okay, so one of the things which is really has been a problem in social science is the lack of commitment, right? So why should we, for example, buy these social products, right? So it has a bit of a, well, it's more expensive than general products, and, well, it has said that it's being for, well, eco-hippies, or I've tried to search for a translation for it, but geitenwolle sokken, and it really doesn't have any form of translation, I believe, in English. But, well, you get the general idea, right? With gamification, we're focused on motivation, right? To get people to do stuff which is actually interesting to do, right? To make it more fun, in a certain sense. So, for example, here's Pain Squad. And Pain Squad is an app for children who are diagnosed with cancer. And, well, you know, I mean, they really have to do all of these books of information, so they have to record their information, and it's really not interesting for them, it's really dull, A. And B, the problem was that, well, they just had these chemos, right? And chemo is, like, really exhausting, and they get really tired, right? So it was all really dramatic to do that. And Pain Squad is actually designed to make it for them interesting to do these inquiries, because they were a part of a police squad, or called Pain Squad in this case, and they are then doing a sort of business case for them, or an investigation case, which they have to fill out these forms in a playful way, right? So, in a natural way, this game is becoming a part of this design, and also with social design, we can also add this idea of, for example, in this case, filling in the forms, but also in other cases of social design, we can add this type of games to make people more aware of what is going on here. There's also the second point, being that it creates awareness, right? So often it's difficult to convey the message just as a message, right? I mean, I can talk about what social design is. But gamification can help to motivate this learning, okay? So for example, learning the fundamental reason becomes easier. So here we have this game. This is from ACMIA. And ACMIA has designed this game where we have this life path, right? So here's a life path, and through that, so you can insert all kinds of stuff happening to your life, right? And then they decide what is the best insurance policy for you. But originally, the interesting thing of this is that, well, by simply, you can play with it in a certain sense, right? So you can add all types of things happening, right? You can see what is happening to you is happening to your life, right? And also you can see what's happening for your insurance. And in this case, also for your pension. And so the interesting stuff of this is that you learn playfully what is happening with all of these important decisions, and often tough decisions regarding your financial situation, and you can learn it in a playful way what the impact will be for this. Okay, so next thing is gamification as productive design. So this is actually using games so gamification as social practice in some sense. So here we have this game called NanoCrafter, and it's a really difficult puzzle. Okay, but the interesting stuff is that when doing this difficult puzzle, you're actually helping doing research, right? So there are all different difficult kind of puzzles for molecules, right? And all protein research is really difficult, right? And you have an enormous amount of computation needed, and this idea is that while people are going to play this game, they're actually solving these issues, right, regarding proteins, right? So people are want to be the best in nanocrafting, right? So they're going to try to figure a good solution to that. And actually this good solution is going to give a solution, or at least a hint of solution, to the researchers in proteins, okay? So that's just a really cool idea of just, well, ensuring that people are actually helping you, even if they will probably realize it, but still you're just helping, right, by playing a game, right? So it's just fun to do. Right, so this is, well, you're really just, you know, switching molecules. Okay, so what we're going to do is on a meta level. Right, so we're going to use pervasive gaming. And what is pervasive gaming? Well, pervasive gaming is basically where the magic circle, I'm not certain whether everyone is familiar with the magic circle, but the magic circle was a term coined by Johan Huizinga, a Dutch researcher who made a definition of a game, and he defined that a game, well, basically the thing with a game is that we're attributing different meanings towards all kinds of events, right? So if I'm, for example, in the real world, I would say that when I have kicked a ball in the net, right? However, when I'm within a magic circle, it's actually called scoring a goal, right? So this magic circle is a place and time where there are different rules, right? Well, with pervasive gaming, we're actually saying, well, no, where this magic circle becomes a veil over our real world, okay? So we're going to make it more or less similar between those two. Okay, so we're not saying, well, no, it's sometimes scoring goal and sometimes it's kicking a ball net. Or better to say, actually we're going to say, well, this rule about scoring goal, now whenever we're in the real world, it's also called scoring goal. Right? So we're going to vegan the difference between playing a game and being in the real world. So examples are alternative reality games, live action role playing, and cross media games. And one of them, I actually have an example. So this is Pac-Manhattan, right? So this is a game which is being played in Manhattan, and you have this two people who are playing at a large board, right? And they had contacts via cell phones. And so when, for example, Pac-Man was walking, right, they would say, well, you have to go to the next street, you have to go to the left, right? And so they would have this vision about where the players would be and where, so the monsters, some of them would be monsters and some of them would be Pac-Man, would be walking at that moment. And another example is Google's Impress, which is actually a game which you can play on your mobile phone, and it's still busy at this moment. Show you
there's more to the world than you can truly see. You've sensed it, but you cannot tell. Something is very wrong. Strange occurrences. Visions affecting us. Are we being watched? I'm a truth seeker with many questions. The most important is, Niantic Project.
Right, so when you're using your phone, you're having this app, right? Through augmented reality, so by looking at your phone, which is putting literally a veil over what you are seeing, you will see all different kinds of stuff happening, right? So you will see clues, or you will see stuff happening on your screen. Okay. So the first step is that we're going to use pervasive game, but then we're going to see, well, we're going to assume that the difference between real world economies and old world economies can be translated in the forms of game rules mechanics. 2 minutes? Okay, right. So, for example, the industrial marketing perspective, right? So the idea that we're simply just creating cool stuff and people just have to buy it, right? Well, it's more or less a slaughter game, actually, right? So there's nothing, I'm not interacting with the persons I'm designing for, right? So when we go to the business to consumer perspective, I'm going into a competitive game, right? Because I want to win the consumer instead of someone else. And then with the civic economy, we're going to get in a sort of cooperative game, right? Because we have to work together. And also with the sharing economy, we have to work together with my consumers, right? So there's example. Right. So sample rule themes. For example, we're going to talk about trust. We're going to talk about the idea of a prosumer. The organizational differences, right? So early on, we had this kind of idea of a hierarchical situation. Later, we get the idea of a rhizome, right? Where we have, well, you can really say that there is a center where everything is arranged. And even later, we get the idea of, could be sharper, the idea of a cellular automata, which basically says that, well, every point has just a certain set of rules about the state it was originally in, and then it changes, and these changes can actually make something which couldn't be derived from the Euro rules, right? Simply because there are only rules for interaction, okay? So, for example, when the three next to me, the two next to me are on, and I'm also on, then I become off. Well, and these rules are made for all of the points, right? So these are simply, this is a transition in time. From the above is the beginning and down is the end. And here you see that it doesn't create a literal pattern, right? It doesn't create something which we would expect it to create, right? Because here suddenly you get these type of forms and suddenly they disappear and we get all other type of forms. So it means that there, something can emerge from it, right? So this is also the case with these new economies, we get a sort of emerging systems, right? Which is beyond the whole idea of a rhizome because there is something organized in the beginning, even with that simple rules, right? Just 9 rules, nothing more. Okay. And also there's a discussion about expert ownership. I have to talk fast about it. Okay. So, transgonism means that basically we're going to provide experience into new economic models by positioning the old and the new against each other, right? And of course, we'll be getting discussion about, well, our visions are the descriptive or the normative, and, well, where's the Dirichlet elements still left?